to have Keith Maskus from University of Colorado to give us a seminar. This is a joint seminar between the Institute for Emerging Market Studies as well as the Department of Economics in HKUST. Keith is a very prolific scholar. His specialty is, of course, international trade. All sorts of areas of international trade, and he has written in almost every area in international trade. But he's especially an expert in intellectual property rights related trade issues. So today we're very happy to have him talk about this topic. So it's yours.
Thank you, Edwin. So I'm feeling a little jet lagged. I'll probably be a bit incoherent. You know, just ask questions and see if I can answer. I got into studying intellectual property rights a long time ago. I don't know if I ever told you this, but the reason that I did is because a very famous trade economist of that era in the 90s, Robert Baldwin, Dick Baldwin's father, Richard Baldwin's father, asked me to present a paper at some conference he was putting together on the new issues, the Uruguay round. So I said, sure, I would do something on intellectual property rights. That was in about 1991. I haven't been able to escape this thing since then. This is a joint paper with a graduate student of mine, Bill Wade Ridley. You can see the title of this. So let me try to explain what's going on here. I'll go through a lot of this. The essential question is this. Since the early 1990s, the United States and more recently the European Union have been negotiating regional and bilateral trade agreements that have in them exceptionally strong chapters covering intellectual property. And you'll see the evolution of that here shortly. And in a sense, this goes back to where the economics knowledge of this issue, of these sort of regional trade agreements and intellectual property rights, goes back to how things were during the Uruguay round, which I mentioned. The agreement that was reached in the WTO on intellectual property rights is called the Agreement on Trade-Related Intellectual Property Rights. And at that time, in the early to mid-90s, if you asked anybody if there was any evidence that intellectual property rights are trade-related, they could not have answered that question because nobody had studied it. So that was sort of the first paper I did. And now here we are with these bilateral agreements that have these strong IP chapters in them. And so the same question comes up. Is the fact that these things have additional protections for intellectual property having any additional trade impacts that you wouldn't get from regular trade agreement or just from being in the WTO TRIPS agreement? That's not an easy thing to sort out, I can tell you. And this paper is really a first attempt. It's straightforwardly empirical in this context. But the idea is to try to see if we can identify something specific from these intellectual property chapters. And I think the short answer is it's hard to find stuff, but there is an interesting answer that we'll get to at the end. So, say a little bit about the scope of these global reforms and IPRs, talk a bit about these TRIPS plus chapters in preferential trade agreements. Say a bit again about how they could matter for trade and other economic activity. Then spend most of the time on econometric specifications, identification issues, and data. And I should say in passing, this is still pretty preliminary. So just to give you one example, when you get there, when you're doing bilateral trade with 100 and some countries, the total potential data set over a panel is in the many millions. And so to estimate like that with 95% of the observations being zeros requires a lot of computing power. So we haven't gotten to that point yet. But so any suggestions you have about econometric specifications and so on, I'd be happy to hear. And then just some conclusions on where this
All right, so when empirical international economists analyze trade agreements, they are, and certainly I'm in the same category, in the category of the old joke about the drunk, the alcoholic who's out looking for his lost car keys under the street light, and somebody comes along and says, "Why are you looking up here?" He says, "Where did you lose it?" He says, "Way over there, back there." And he says, "Why don't you go look up there?" He says, "Well, it's dark over there." It's the same thing. We study detailed, nuanced information about tariffs, because we have all this information about tariffs, and you look at tariff preferences and all this stuff, it has important effects. But these days, I would say at least since the early 2000s, the arguably more important element of trade agreements is not tariffs, although it could be, you don't know. But it's all the regulatory issues that these agreements have begun to incorporate. And we know so little about the effects they have. So here's examples. Rules of origin, investment regulation, competition policy, financial market regulation, technical product standards, labor protection, on and on and on and on. If you ever sat down and read the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, now the CPTPP, and if you decide to do that, get yourself a really strong copy and an entire 2-day period. But what you would discover is there are like some 32 or 33 substantive chapters in that agreement, and only one of them is about tariff cutting. Okay? So it's a lot more than that. And a highly significant regulatory area is protection of intellectual property rights, patents, plant variety rights, copyrights, trade secrets, on and on and on, which are, of course, exclusive rights to use, produce, sell, import, maybe goods and technologies for some period of time. In return, inventors have to disclose their knowledge, and the expectation is the social bargain is that they'll bring their new ideas, their new knowledge to the marketplace. So why are IPRs important for trade and investment in principle? I'll talk a little bit more about the ambiguous theory here in a few minutes. But if you think about it, virtually any product or service you ever buy has intellectual property rights attached to it. Least trademarks, typically a lot more than that. Again, anything that you might buy, a cell phone has it in it, something like, depending on the vintage of that cell phone, between 50 and 300 patented technologies, which all have to work together and patent in different countries, and this is an extremely complicated question. And the trade effects of that kind of technology just swamp, I think, the tariff issue. So it's important. They affect fundamental strategic trade-offs. So I just mentioned standard essential patents and electronics. Technological change itself demands updates and IPOs. And so that has impacts on trade investment, and so trade agreements themselves get updated as well. In my mind, I'm not sure I actually believe this. IPRs are renowned for certain international problems. I've studied them for so long and for so many times that I don't think I've understudied them. But we're sort of really at the beginning of understanding how these things all work, okay? As a matter of trade and investment. So again, a little bit more on what's been happening. The last 20 years or so have seen an unprecedented expansion of IP protection. So first there was this TRIPS agreement at the WTO. What was important about that is that for the first time it made international agreements on intellectual property subject to dispute resolution. That had never been the case before. And in addition to that, if you join the WTO, and everybody in the world is except for a few very small countries, then you have to accept all of the provisions of the WTO, including the TRIPS agreement. So overnight, you have to have pretty strong intellectual property rights, at least in your laws. I guess we can go on. I do want to mention, though, what the TRIPS actually says about intellectual property rights specifically is if you move beyond TRIPS and reform
your intellectual property system, then you have to do that on an MFN basis. You can't have a trade agreement that says my trading partners in this agreement get special patent privileges. You can't do that, right? This has to be done on an MFN basis, which is something that's quite different from preferential tariff cutting.
There are additional treaties and rules at the World Intellectual Property Organization, and then there's TRIPS Plus requirements and PTAs. I just mentioned this MFN requirement. And then, of course, something else that economists haven't really studied very much is the fact that bilateral investment treaties, international investment agreements, and preferential trade agreements, all of the ones signed since probably the late 90s, have in them language that says intellectual property rights are investment assets that are protected by investor suits. So if you don't know what I mean, and it's just an aside, it's nothing to do with this paper, but recently, under the terms of NAFTA, the government of Canada vacated two patents that the Canadian Patent Office had given to Eli Lilly on a couple of drugs. Eli Lilly had not yet even begun to commercialize them. But they sued under the investor suit resolution system of NAFTA, saying that in fact, by the court having vacated these patents, and the patents in retrospect clearly should never be granted, after it is, Eli Lilly said they were granted, they were ours, we own them, they were worth billions of Canadian dollars, and we're going to sue the Canadian government to extract that revenues. Now, it turned out that the arbitration panel in that case found against Eli Lilly. Nevertheless, you get the idea, right? I mean, these policies are pretty significant.
Okay. I just ask a very simple clarification question. So when I think of an intellectual property right, am I just thinking about person X has a property right for Y years, or is there a lot more detail to intellectual property
rights? Well, person X has a prescribed set of rights in the law, depending on the form of the intellectual property right, it's for a particular time period. But trademarks last as long as you want to register them, re-register them, for example. So that's permanent protection. The European Database Directive, which is an intellectual property kind of right, that lasts forever, even though it's sort of a patent-like thing. So it just depends. But yeah, with patents, you get this thing, it defines exactly what your rights are, what the limits to the rights are, and then how long you have to. Is that the question? So quickly, I'll just give you some sense of what's been going on. 1985, the U.S. and Israel signed the Free Trade Agreement. First one that ever mentioned intellectual property rights. All it says is, do your best. There's one sentence. You have to have one paragraph. So national treatment and MFN. Otherwise, just whatever your law is, protect it. In NAFTA, 1994, basically the language in NAFTA is what TRIPS was built. In 2001, the U.S. negotiated agreement with Jordan, which at the time was called the gold standard in intellectual property protection. 5 pages of IP protection added some additional features, particularly test data protection for pharmaceuticals, some extension of patents, and so on. U.S. and Chile in 2004, it actually was the first agreement that did 2 things. One is to put in patents and plant varieties. The other is to make these test data periods, I don't know what I mean, but basically confidential test data means if you're trying to get your drug approved or your chemical approved in a particular market, the government can take your regulatory data that you've submitted to get this approval and give it to some generic competitor. So the question is for how long can you prevent that from happening? This is this sort of extended that considerably. Australia in 2005 put in linkage requirements which says generics can't enter the market without, except under certain rigorous circumstances. Korea in 2012, additional limits on copyrights, patents for new uses of medicines, no pre-grant opposition, which is just crazy, basically, since in Korea they agreed to change their patent law in such a way that even though the patent looked like it was going to be invalid, nobody could oppose it until after the fact, which is the American law. So you get the idea. Basically, what the Americans have been doing is exporting their intellectual property system through these agreements. And then there was the original trans
partnership, which had really strong protection for things like biologics and trade secret obligations, and so on. And then the EU, since about 2005, has been doing the same thing with its own partnership agreements, asking for very strong protection.
May I ask
a
example
in
your previous page, say, for Korea, after they implemented such rigorous enforcement for intellectual property protection, then is there any existing study to show that it's either encouraging innovation or suppressing innovation?
No. No. It's a fairly new agreement, so I think it would be hard to find anything like that. But not
finding it. Yeah.
I have to say that, if you're an IO economist who specializes in innovation, you know this, but no one else realizes this. One of the most amazing things about empirical IO is that, despite the fact that for hundreds of years the claim has been that patents stimulate innovation, there's virtually no evidence that that's true. And the reason it's very hard to do the sort of isolated random experiment that would get you the kind of data that would generate that kind of an outcome. There's some very interesting work on historical data done by Petra Moser on these questions, and she sort of finds that there is some evidence of it. But so what would you do? This is a national patent law. What you really need is some exogenous shift in enforcement in a particular industry in a particular location that doesn't happen somewhere else to see if there's a difference over time in innovation rates. And that just doesn't happen. Anyway, that's a long answer to your question. Nobody studied this yet in Korea.
Yes, Jeff.
Hi, Jeff.
Hi.
Okay. So, one thing you might not know, maybe you do, is that preferential trade agreements themselves are a pretty recent phenomenon. Okay. Preferential trade agreements with intellectual property chapters in them are very recent. And so they really all begin in the early 90s, and then you get this proliferation up to now in these kinds of movements. So it's a pretty, like I said, pretty recent phenomenon, pretty unstudied. The implied international linkages are becoming really complex. You might find this interesting. So on the left is just a diagram of networks in preferential trade agreements in 1995, and you see that only within the European Union and then a couple of localized agreements did you have any sort of IP chapters in these agreements. But now, in 2010, you can see how dense these networks are, both generally with pretty trade agreements and with these IP chapters. Okay. So this is, I think it's fair to say, an enormous change in policy norms about which we know very little. Also significant that trade agreements that have been coming online involve all kinds of regulatory protection or barriers or whatever you think about them. Behind the border kinds of regulations, IPRs are actually fairly low on scale compared to some of these other things like competition and investment. Okay, I'm almost done with this sort of background motivation. As of 2015, if you're interested, there are 50 preferential trade agreements that have IP chapters of varying complexity. Most of them involve a developed country partner, but some of the newer South-South agreements do have IP chapters in them. And you can see, I don't really have an answer for why that is, but you can see why it would be, because if you're Chile or Argentina or Chile, Peru, or Colombia, you've already got an agreement in the United States or Europe that requires these kinds of restrictions, and you got to be MFN about it. There's no point in negotiating an agreement with another developing country that doesn't have the ruling. So there it is. 82 countries are now members of at least one such agreement. There they are. I'll come back in a second. But this is important. We're going to define our treatment preferential trade agreements as those that involve either the United States or the European Union or the European Free Trade Association as a partner country. For the simple reason that they're the countries that demand these exceptions, these increases in IP protection. that's just a graphical representation of what we what's in the data. So on the left, in the left diagram is the number of countries that are in and the number of agreements that are in all IP-related PTAs, but in the middle is the U.S. ones and the right the European ones, how many countries there are in them and how many agreements there are. So, oh, if you're interested in this kind of thing, there are, it's a whole sub-industry now to put together indexes of behind-the-border regulatory protection and trade agreements. So there are guys in Europe doing this, the World Bank has indexes like that. It isn't just IP, it's all these kinds of things. So you can do a lot of analysis of this thing. Also, the coverage of these agreements varies a fair amount between U.S. Agreements and between European agreements. The only thing I'll say about this is the strongest sort of TRIPS plus expectations in these agreements, they come in two flavors. One is about pharmaceuticals, regulation of drugs and medicines. So I could go through that in detail. There was some of them on the screen earlier. But in essence, if you sign these days, or going back 20 years, if you sign a preferential trade agreement with the United States, the Americans will insist that you not just give patents to pharmaceuticals, that's already, TRIPS requires that, but that you have all kinds of regulatory changes in place. So you have longer patent protection to compensate for regulatory delays. You can allow somebody who owns a patent to get a new patent or extended patent because that company's come up with a new use for the patent. You can block parallel trade in some contexts. You can do it depends on the agreement. And there are these so-called linkage requirements, which basically say if a generic company has been approved to enter your market, it can't enter the market until it informs the patent owner, and then the patent owner has a period of time basically to buy the generic patent. That's what these things say. It's quite protective. And then the other area is information communication technologies through a lot of copyright issues and patent issues. So if that's the case, we would argue sort of at the outset that probably those are the areas in which you want to see something. Okay. So all of this suggests a pretty rich area for trade research on the economic effects of these regulatory chapters of PTAs. Here's a series of questions you could ask. This paper is only about the first one. Do IP-related PTAs matter beyond the effects of TRIPS? Are there impacts on licensing and FDI innovation and so on? How would you go about studying that? And then lots of questions that can be asked you. One that I think is really interesting and working on with some people is this issue about are there interactions between IPRs and tariff cutting in these preferential trade agreements? Because if you think about it, if you're a developing country, you know the government is, the Americans are coming in, they're going to have this set of standards you've got to agree to, then that might affect your willingness to set your tariff reductions against the Americans during this agreement. So the question is whether there's some sort of substitution between these two policies. It's an interesting question, but absolutely no study. So this is a first attempt at the most basic question, and I think it's not as successful at this point as we'd like it to be, but working on it. Do these IP-related preferential trade agreements have exceptional effects on member countries' aggregate and bilateral trade flows? And what about in specific IP sectors? And as I said already, the paper is quite empirical. Its results at this point, I think, raise more questions than they answer, but it's still some interesting things. And I guess the last couple of slides before getting to the specification. This, anybody who's in this area knows that the IP and how it affects trade, to say the least, is inherently an empirical question. Because you can write down models that generate increases in trade, you can write down models that generate decreases in trade, and how this all works out depends on what you think matters in a particular context, but just examples might be that you
put in patent rights, foreign firms realize the market's expanding for them, so they trade more. Or they might trade less if they become more monopolistic. How they decide to enter into markets may be endogenous to the patent reforms, right? So it may be that you see trade exports into a country reduced by these kinds of agreements, and that doesn't mean there's less of it going on. It might be because international firms decide to enter by invest more direct investment in building on a local affiliate, a local facility that is going to produce stuff instead of trading it. And then there's also evidence out there in the data that that with a lag, emerging economies that adopt stronger IP protection and patents at least do tend to start exporting more high technology products, and we don't know really why that is. But there are some trade-offs here. It may be that you get local limitation costs rising, so domestic firms are under some stress from this, but a lot of technology spillovers to affiliates will generate more and then finally, it's possible to write down some models where heterogeneous firms are presented with these kinds of trade-offs. And what you can get in that kind of a context, depending on the assumptions you're willing to make, I believe, is that there's an endogenous selection into the higher productivity firms of both innovation and exports. But as I was explaining to Amber on the way back up from the city, we don't know a lot. This is really interesting stuff to me, and I'm working on this in a number of contexts, but one thing we know about as an empirical observation, nothing to do with this paper, is that emerging economies with more developed financial markets that then also reform their patent rights, their patent laws, tend to have a bigger export expansion effect than those that, that don't have such developed financial markets. So I think there's probably something going on in terms of how that interaction influences the fixed costs of market entry. We don't need to go through all of this literature. That's just a series of recent empirical papers on this kind of subject. But none of this is really about regulatory issues in bilateral trade agreements. Okay. So, identification approach. See, if you buy this, this is what we do here. So, we got mostly, until the end, we'll need to do a sort of gravity specification, a difference in difference approach to study both imports and exports of countries that may or may not be in these treatment agreements. So we try to apply this method to both TRIPS effects and conditional on being a member of TRIPS or compliant with TRIPS to subsequent entry into a trade agreement. If you don't do that, it's really problematic, right? Because TRIPS sets a baseline. And so anybody who is already compliant with TRIPS, when you join a trade agreement, there might be some marginal expansion. But if you don't make that distinction, it's going to be a problem. In the example, we have all countries in the contract data set over this 20-year period. Exports and imports broken down into different types of sectors, but basically higher IP goods or versions of higher IP goods and low IP goods. So just to give you a sense of it, low IP goods are things like textiles and apparel, basic production, construction materials, that sort of thing, basic goods. Whereas high IP goods are what you expect, things that are highly patented, so pharmaceuticals, we also break these sectors down further into specific IP-intensive sectors such as biopharmaceuticals and ICT, information communication technologies. As I already said, those are the big areas that get specific protection in these agreements. So the identification is based on some differences here. One is that a subset of countries joined one of these, I call them IPAs, so it's a trade, a preferential trade agreement with enforceable intellectual property rights in them that exceed the TRIPS standards. That's the definition. And we identify those by going through and looking at what these agreements actually say, but the treatment is one of the partner countries is either the United States or it's the European Union, because they're the ones who demand these things.
So a subset of countries joined this, others did not. They'll be the control group of countries. And so, you know, if you have any thoughts on this, I'd like to hear them. This is an idea that says you, your country, could join a trade agreement, but it's not in the treatment group unless it's a trade agreement with the United States or Europe that has this kind of strong intellectual property protection. So a lot of trade agreements don't have those kinds of things, or they're with other countries. So we have a dummy variable for the year of joining and after, and also this is we break this down by income to see if there's some distinction across income groups. There's a corresponding difference in dates at which countries become compliant with the TRIPS agreement. That's not an easy thing to discover, it turns out. And the second difference is, given the nature of these agreements, we argue that these differences should matter between the high IP goods and the low IP goods, or even more specifically, between pharmaceuticals and everything else. Okay. All right. So, as I already said this, our specification focused on countries that are already compliant with TRIPS before they join one of these IPAs, and that actually takes out any trade agreement of this kind that was signed before 1995. So particularly NAFTA is not a treaty group, it's not in this analysis. Okay, so trade data, we mentioned this, how we do this. Lots of zeros in trade data, so in what you're gonna see, all the zeros are just eliminated from the analysis and our estimation on the remaining data, but we're working on that. Big zeros question. Yes, okay. So we've identified 24 treatment PTAs. Countries on the treatment group, they had joined any one of these during the sample. And maybe that's not very good either, I don't know, because what it says is you can join one of these, or two of these, or three of these, but if you join at least one, you're in this treatment group. And I think it'd be interesting to try to find out if multiple entries matter in this context. There are countries like Peru that have an agreement with the United States and with Europe, right? Mexico has such an agreement. Right now, we can't sort that out. All right. So, if you're interested, those are the agreements, but here's just a sort of a quick review of the data prior to the analysis between treatment groups and control groups. I'm not sure what to say about this. Most of it's unsurprising. So among the high-income countries, the treatment countries are bigger because they're the most developed countries with the biggest markets typically who join these agreements. But that's not the case necessarily anywhere else. So middle-income countries, the control groups tend to be a little bit bigger, especially the low. And I have to be honest right up front about something. China is in the low-income group. So the reason is we want to make sure that we're not changing the sample between country income groups over the period of time we analyze this. So China, well, everybody is defined as being in particular income groups based upon their 1995. And at that time, China was a low-income country. It's not any longer, but you can see some of these big changes in the sizes and so on of low-income countries. That's China. So we need to sort of re-estimate these things without China. Those of you who are in this literature, I think that would be you and me. You've heard of the Jeannard-Tapark Index? That's a sort of attempt to measure the legal protection that countries offer to patents. And what the only thing I'll say about that is that there's really not much distinction between the treatment and control groups in the middle-income countries. A little bit lower in the control countries. That's where all of the action is in terms of these attempts by the United States and Europe to get these agreements, because it's in these sort of middle-income emerging countries that they really are worried about competition in some of these technological areas. So it doesn't look like there's a lot of bias there, but I'll say a little bit more about that in a moment.
US and EU, that's not like income group.
terms of the treatment decision?
Yes. So within the EU, you can imagine some countries have some countries everyone.
Well, I'm not sure exactly what the question is. So if you're a low-income country in the EU, you're in the treatment definition,
yes.
But you're in one of these income groups.
No, I'm just asking, like, not all like the same, well, not all EU countries have the same income for
Oh, that's true, but the European Commission itself has been under orders, if that's the right word, since about 2006 to negotiate these very high IP agreements. So they're not very different from the US agreements in that context. The biggest distinction between them is that the Europeans demand protection for their wines and cheeses, and we don't. But otherwise, in terms of pharmaceuticals, there's not a lot of difference.
So the entire EU actually adopt the same standard, right?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
Can't be in the EU without harmonizing the standards.
Right.
But even so the definition or the selection of the treatment definition is one of the partner countries is either the United States or Europe, because we're pretty confident just from the history of these things that they're the ones who are demanding these large or sort of these extensive protected chapters in intellectual property. And I'll try to convince you of this in a moment. You're probably not going to believe it, or I'll buy it. But it's a little hard to argue, I think, that Peru on its own would choose to go to the United States and let's negotiate a trade agreement that has in it a strong intellectual property protection that would change their patents in ways they wouldn't otherwise select to do. Am I getting at your question or not?
Yes, I'm just wondering, because I see that there are quite a few countries with IP-related
talking about that chart back
then?
I probably shouldn't have done. Try to go back there.
Sorry.
It takes taking too long. There it is.
This one, I think a lot of countries are, a lot of these agreements are not US or EU, so why do they kind of do this?
So if you, this is close to the sum of these two, one on the left. So if you look at this, this is like 52 countries here and about 21 countries there. So it's, I'm not sure who the sort of additional stragglers are up there. But I think the one on the left is basically just the sum of the two on the right. Otherwise, it may not have been drawn correctly. Yeah, but we don't put those into our treatment. And Japan has very few trade agreements to speak of at all, much less with these IP requirements.
Maybe not even a new one coming up.
Well, the only one that the Japanese have entered into that would be in the treatment group, but they just signed it, is with Europe. And they're saying they're not going to do it in the United States. I don't know. Do you know?
Yeah, no, that's what they say at the moment. Yeah. Well, it's you know. Robbie's running again for presidency of the OEP, so he can't say that.
Okay. So, this is what I was saying a minute ago. You're probably going to buy this. The big question in any analysis of this kind is an endogeneity problem. Right? So, do countries self-select into these agreements because they want to have strong intellectual property protection? Your empirical paper with Isabel, was it? You would say something about this. Right? So the TRIPS agreement pushed everybody off a non-cooperative solution into a sort of unwelcome cooperative solution or something like that. I don't remember exactly the details.
Mm-hmm.
But the idea here is at this stage, when you get everything together, we're going to be doing a little bit more formal stuff on this question of exogeneity. At this stage, we're going to take TRIPS and IPR's rules and PTAs to be exogenously imposed on most trading partners. And here's the idea. So TRIPS was part of the WTO. It was demanded by those three countries, United States, European Union, and Japan, and by no one else. It was very controversial. And the only way it got into the WTO was through this single undertaking. If you decided to join the WTO, you had to accept everything in the WTO, including the TRIPS agreement. And so that was just an unbreakable demand for these countries. All the other countries decided to join for whatever reason, and mostly by getting market access through the WTO agreements more broadly. You could search far and wide in press accounts in India or China, or Brazil at the time, and not find anything that says that these countries really wanted to have the TRIPS agreement there. It was just the opposite. They were trying to avoid it. As far as these IP TRIPS Plus agreements are concerned, these trade agreements, again, these are demands made by one trading partner with considerably larger bargaining power. Now, I think it's probably not the case that most developing and emerging countries would choose to adopt these rules endogenously or to select into an agreement with them because they want to have those agreements. They might want to have agreements for other reasons. So even though I think that's a reasonable statement, and by the way, just so you know, the dozen or so empirical papers that are looking at how TRIPS affects trade make this kind of assumption that it's an exogenously imposed restriction on these countries or expectations. But if you're interested, here's just some simple first stage national levels, so small sample size, loge estimations of the probability of joining one of these agreements. So when you get to the endowments, physical capital, human capital, that sort of lowers the sample size to 130 or 140. But what you find, when you put all of these things together, the only sort of economic variable that really matters in terms of selection is this share of high IP imports that come from the OECD countries. So that seems to be one determinant of whether you actually join these agreements or not. And there's some concern about endogeneity there, I would agree. This is kind of interesting. So I don't know if you know anything about what the American policy all along has been here, but in this, the United States has this law called Special 301, which has long since been forgotten about by most people because WTO sort of forced the United States to stop using this thing until quite recently.
Yeah, not anymore.
Special 301 is a version of the U.S. unfair trade law that says that it's about intellectual property. So it says if there's a country that Americans think is not treating its firms correctly in terms of intellectual property rights, they go either on a watch list country, which means we're watching you but we're not hearing about it, or a priority list country, which means that you're so bad at this we're going to consider retaliating. On occasion, they did. But that's been a long time ago. But through this period, the American USTR, they issue an annual report, and they still put these countries on watch lists and priority lists. And you want to know the sort of difference between them. Canada's every year on the watch list because we don't like their copyright laws. But China and Brazil are every year so what this says, if you think about it, this is all very loose at this point. If you think that what the Americans and Europeans are doing, and the Europeans can read these agreements as well as Americans can, so they know what's going on too. If you think that what they're doing is trying to get the really bad actors to raise their intellectual property rights by forcing them to sign an IP-related trade agreement, it seems to me that's not true, right? Because there's a negative correlation.
In a practical sense, it was used by a lot of companies during its heyday as a bargaining tool to try to push changes that with the countries they were trying to deal with, especially places in Asia, with frankly mixed success. Then, but the U.S. was a lot more powerful then.
Sure.
So now I wonder if
Well, I don't know, does anybody pay attention to this anymore?
Well, I don't think so. Not many.
So you're, I'm trying to understand your OECD high IP impact share.
Mm-hmm.
So if a country import a lot of high IP good from OECD?
So there's high IP imports,
right,
which is the volume measure.
Right.
And the OECD share of those high IP imports.
Okay.
So the high IP imports, when you put all this together, that doesn't seem to have, or exports, any effect on this selection decision.
Mm-hmm.
And you'd think that that would be the issue, right? Because big volumes of trade is what you would push you into these trade agreements. But the share of those high IP imports coming from the OECD seems to have a pretty strong correlation with this decision.
I would have expected a negative sign, though, because then the greater the import share of the OECD, the more this will hurt you, right?
The more what?
This trade agreement will hurt you in the sense of you're not being able to copy whatever it is that you're importing and create your own domestic version of it.
Right, so no, I think that's a fair claim altogether. But the question that we're trying to get at here so far in this sort of loose way is, can you make a credible, strong argument that the Americans and the Europeans are selecting countries to join these agreements based upon something endogenous, and therefore you've got sort of a problem to worry about econometrically?
You could also have you could also look at it the other way, which is which countries choose to enter into an agreement with the U.S.
Sure.
The EU. And it doesn't, I know you made a point on the previous slide that nobody wants to be in this. Nobody wants to have IPRs. No developing country wants to have IPRs.
Well, not at this level, I think, right? Yeah.
But it's not about wanting IPRs. It might be that it's the ones that dislike it the least that enter into the agreement, right?
Could be. I mean, I think mostly the reasons for joining these agreements is you want market access and certainty and all of that.
So you're
generate more FDI.
Looking at some trade-off between the gains from market access and the losses from this greater IP protection.
Right. So if you have the least objection,
that's
a good point, actually. And these countries rarely are very poor, right? They're sort of on the cusp of having some. Good question. Well, I thought you'd find that kind of interesting, but it's no proof of anything yet. I think we need to work more on that. But it does kind of suggest it isn't just a systematic thing that's going on here in terms of the selection of these countries into these agreements. Okay, we've already talked about this. Do the IPAs have some effect on these agreements? Is there differential effect of TRIPS? Conditions, regression. So there's. And I apologize. I'm just putting these slides together on the airplane coming over here. So these are all PDF templates, copy and paste. But you can see this is the simplest or basic specification. So trade is from country I if it's an exporter to country I if it's an importer in sector S, which is either high IP or low IP, and that's not an exhaustive set of industries, so there's a big group that we don't classify in the middle, so there should be some distinction between these things. In year T, so GDP is getting to the exporter, the importer, and then we allow for this interaction between high IP goods and GDP just to see if what seems reasonable, there's some additional elasticity to market size. But the rest of this is just a standard diff and diff, so beta 3 is the direct effect of joining one of these agreements basically on low IP goods. Okay. And then there's an interaction with income on that joining decision. So that's kind of the income condition impact on these control commodities. And the interesting coefficient we're most interested in is beta 5, which is the high IP goods times per capita income times joining this agreement. And if you think there's some impact of these kinds of agreements, then you expect beta 5 to be positive.
So the left hand side is what is trade? Is trade flow or
it's trade flow?
Trade
now, this
flow.
Is right now, this is aggregate. There's not bilateral. There'll be bilateral comes later.
Ah.
So country I, subscript I means either you're an exporter, in which case we have an export equation, or you're an importer, in which case we have an import equation. We're looking at those two separately.
Okay. So you. So the, what is the purpose of this regression?
To see if there's any sort of differential effect on exports or imports in the high IP goods.
Okay.
Conditioning for the fact that you're in TRIPS.
Okay.
And then this is a very rigorous set of fixed effects down there, I think. So G is it's not in this equation yet, it will be in a minute, but that's a group, income group effect also. So GST is group sector time. And then there's a fixed effect for every country, but not just the country, it's country time effect. So that is pretty specific or pretty comprehensive. No? And I guess we've gone through all of this already. Okay. Well, okay, so it's awful to read when you've got them all in front of you anyway. We find at this stage is that market size and market size interactions are important. No problem there. You didn't want these. In fact, if you ran one of these things and found the GDP didn't matter, that would be a problem. Okay, so the positive effect of GDP and the interaction of IIP goods with GDP. But what about this IPA variable? So a lot of coefficients. And trying to make sense of it is not the most straightforward thing. But let me just sort of point out a couple. This is the first baseline specification. There are others that will modify and qualify this. So exports. It appears in this that the direct effect of joining one of these IPA agreements is just not that big on trade. Okay. So that coefficient minus one on income. Income 19, so column 1. It's not precisely estimated by any means, but if that were precisely estimated, it was significant. That would mean that countries that join one of these IPA agreements actually see their imports, sorry, their exports of low IP goods go down, okay? Which is not too believable in a comparative advantage context. But you can see over here that it appears that there is a substantial reduction in their imports of these commodities. So in some sense, these IPA agreements are doing a comparative advantage kind of thing. But what's kind of interesting here is this set of coefficients, which says that in these high intellectual property goods, which again is pharmaceuticals, communication technologies, those kinds of things that are pretty patent intensive. What you get is that as countries get richer, they have a higher per capita GDP, then these IPA agreements have stronger effects on their exports. Now, where does that impact actually become significant? It's typically in about the third quartile of these estimations of income. So it doesn't seem to work in terms of expanding exports for low-income countries, but for higher-income, middle-income countries, it does. I don't know if there's anything else worth talking about, just except to point out the TRIPS doesn't have much effect. So, at least in this initial specification, the IPA agreement effects seem to be more powerful than the TRIPS agreement.
So this is basically a sort of gravity equation.
It is, except that it's not bilateral trade. So when we get to bilateral trade, we do a gravity.
I see. Yeah.
This is just, this is pretty standard when you're looking at just trade flows in one direction. Right? Put in the market size of the variable, and then all of these fixed effects take care of tariffs and all that stuff. So what we get, and it actually carries through pretty much all of these specifications, is that exports do seem to be stimulated in these technology-oriented commodities at higher levels of income. Okay? It isn't just the highest levels of income.
it isn't just the U.S. and Europe that benefit from this, although we have seen later on that in pharmaceuticals that's especially the case. But middle-income countries, upper middle-income countries, that's the case as well.
So right. Why can't you just look at the export of high IP goods?
That's what this is.
Yeah.
This is the
high IP. Oh, okay, I see, right.
But in a little bit, you'll see actual equations like this for pharmaceuticals and so on.
Yeah, right.
So that's what this chart's about. Now, sadly, I thought by now I'd have standard errors around these bars, because my co-author was working on that, but I didn't send them to him yet. What I could tell you, though, is that this coefficient, it gets significant at about the third quartile, significantly positive about the third quartile. So that's what that is the it's the sum of all of the IPA coefficients. And all of these import coefficients, when you sum them up, they're in summary. There's not much going on there at all. Okay. Does that answer your question? So, what about letting these effects vary by discrete income group? And again, I do want to say that this is all sort of empirical and exploratory. There's a lot of work to be done to sort of make this stuff tight. But what about letting this vary by discrete income group? We have these four income groups defined by the World Bank in 1995. And again, China is in the low income group at the beginning of this period, so they remain in the low income group throughout. I think that's a bit problematic. But otherwise, it's the same specification, just to see if these things vary by these type of groups, by these type of income groups. I can tell you, looking back at this, if I presented that regression, it would have something like 23 coefficients in it, and it's just kind of tedious to look at, and some of the interactions would have to be eliminated because of collinearity. So actually, what we do is go directly to direct estimation of these policy variable coefficients by making sure that all of the income groups are in there, all of the control and treatment products are in there, but suppressing some of these direct and indirect effects. Because what this actually does is generate the total direct coefficients. So let me show you how this works. That's the specification here. Has again the same fixed effects in it. Right, so aggregate high IP versus low IP trade with these definitions. And here, what do we get in this context? We still have this relationship between GDP, market size, and these variables. There is this interesting sort of impact that seems negative in the low-income commodities of these IPA agreements, low-income countries of these IPA agreements for trade. And I don't really know yet what I really think about that, but it's kind of interesting because what economic theory will tell you is that regional trade agreements are discriminatory. They should have some positive effects on trade, some negative effects on trade. This suggests that layering in this intellectual property stuff actually has the effect of reducing trade in some of these low IP commodities, sort of shifting trade away from low IP into high IP. Now, why that is, who knows? Could be sort of because there's an endogenous selection in foreign direct investment or something. We really need to try to sort this out. But this primary result that I was telling you about, that the upper income countries, like the high income countries and the upper middle income countries, this interaction with the treatment goods remains quite positive. And these are total coefficients here. So when you see a significant coefficient there, that's what you should think about this. So consequently, there is some suggestion in these regressions that what these IPA agreements seem to do is is encourage exports of the highest technology commodities, the ones that are most sensitive to these intellectual property rights, but pretty much for the emerging upper middle income countries and for the high income countries, which in these treatment agreements tend to be places like the United States, Germany, and so on. So what we see is that those countries are actually expanding their exports of high technology goods through this kind of
trade. Well, so I'm sorry. Should it not be if somebody's exports increases, somebody's imports increases?
In general, yes, but what we don't have so these selection into commodities, low IP and high IP, it's not exhaustive. Right, so low IP commodities is about 25%, I think that's more like 35% of the total sectors in the trade data, and the high IP commodities are about 15%, there's a big gap between them. So a lot of areas in which that trade could be expanded.
Yeah, but I'm not even talking about those effects, I'm just saying if Germany is exporting more high-tech goods, somebody must be importing more.
So, yeah, again, this is a very good question that we need to try to work out. So this is Germany's or US's or Peru's total exports of these goods.
Right.
Not to the partners in these IPA countries.
Yeah.
Right. So what we don't have in this context, let's see, the control countries would be in the import sector, sorry, it should be in the import countries.
Or is it, does that just mean that it's everybody absorbs it kind of evenly?
It could mean that. But it's a good question. I need to work out exactly. See, what's in that import column is the controlled countries, and of course the high-I and the treatment countries, depending on what's defined there. And so the control countries is universal. The definition of goods is not universal. The definition of countries is pretty close to universal. So consequently, that should be showing up somewhere.
So how would this impact if we drop the U.S. and
the
Germany
from
the
center?
We have U.S.
Yeah, we need to do that. I don't know if the answer to that.
I just want to clarify, I'm sorry. So the left-hand side variable is either the export or import of high IP good.
No, there are two types of goods in these regressions, and each one of them is defined as either a low IP good
or
a high IP good.
Okay.
So if you're low IP, your coefficients are in the ones that don't have the triple interaction, or that don't say high IP, I should say. Okay. So these are the coefficients on the high IP goods, these are the coefficients on the low IP.
Oh, I see.
Okay.
So if you're talking about the left-hand side is high IP good, then we'll just pay attention to the coefficient with the high IP there, and it's not it's totally. Okay, I see. Now I understand. So you have an indicator variable that indicates that it is either high or low.
Yeah, so these triple interactions, they're all indicator variables.
That's right.
Which is why we also did the sort of per capita income specification to see but the results, at least qualitatively, are similar. I'm gonna run out of time. So what I'm going to do is go to look at some of the very specific patent-intensive sectors here. So at this point, if there's a result, the primary one is this: controlling for trips. If you join one of these IP-related preferential trade agreements, that seems to reduce the low IP imports and exports in developing countries. But stimulates these high IP exports to these emerging and high income. So that's not a general equilibrium result by any means. That's just what's coming out of these regressions. And there are lots of specific, lots of arguments you can make about why that might be, or what else to do about it. But let me, so bilateral stray just in, I think involves a lot more observations. Is all it is. So bilateral stray, now we're doing the gravity specification.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you want to see this or not, but again, it's a similar kind of thing. For these higher IP commodities with rich countries or higher income countries, you get, well, that's trips down here, but up here, IP, you get in. So there, the results are almost indistinguishable between the two. But you get this effect, again, that for high IP or technology-oriented commodities, their exports tend to be highly correlated with these agreements at higher levels of income. I think instead of focusing on this bilateral result right here, I'm going to try to move on to these industrial clusters. So, you have to ask yourself, why do the United States and Europe go effort, put in so much time and effort into negotiating these agreements? If you're getting these kinds of results, that's one thing, but you really would think because they spend so much of their time and their effort and their negotiating capital on pharmaceuticals and on, in the case of Europe, wines and cheeses, which we need to look at, haven't done that yet. But also on things like information technologies and machinery and so on, that these results ought to show up in those sectors. So let's see if this. Here are the obvious examples: pharmaceuticals, chemicals, medical devices, and so on. And what these TRIPS Plus standards do is elevate requirements in exactly those sectors. So we find these specific clusters as another indicator for these kinds of products.
About this stuff. So it seems like a lot of the money that's paid for this is for the product, like pharmaceuticals, is going to be paid for the IP itself.
Right.
And IP might not be located in the country of manufacture. So that somebody in Ireland, some subsidiary in Ireland,
sure,
owns the IP for pharma, and then it's manufactured in wherever. Where does who is attributed to the money in this these flows?
Yeah, so that you can't sort out with this kind of analysis at all. This question being asked is, given that the country itself reforms its patent rights because it joins one of these agreements, does that have some effect on its trade pattern and trade volume? Not the question of specifically where is the IP registered. There are different questions, right? But it is the case that these products are being produced, maybe, but certainly being traded in countries that before the agreement didn't have such strong protection, now they have stronger protection. And so the question is not, is ownership of those IP rights in that country, but does somebody apply for those rights in those countries and use those applications? Procedures to try to support trade. I mean, you're sort of asking a little bit different question, which is, yeah, it's California, it's Apple that actually generates all this intellectual property, but they register it for tax reasons somewhere else. Certainly true, but that's not the question we're asking here. The question is there some element of this, some trace of this in the trade data?
Right, I guess what I'm asking is the money that's actually paid for the IP component of the import included in the data that you're measuring? So if I'm actually importing pills,
I see.
Then am I paying some license fee through some income flows and to some, you know, that's not included in the import data or?
Right, so I think the best way to put that question is under limit is if we're noticing an increase in what appears to be the trade volume, is
right.
That because it's a volume effect? associated with a stronger IP protection. And these data are deflated, but in a way that I don't think captures that particularly well. So my answer is maybe, but we have to sort of sort this out.
Another way, suggesting that maybe looking at the tax rates, the corporate tax rates of the exporting countries to see if there are different effects of
that. No, quite right. But I think that those kinds of things would be captured in some of these fixed effects.
Okay.
Well, what about this? Exports of these high IP clusters by using this discrete income definition. Once again, you get this sort of positive effect in market size. The first column is the control group, so low IP commodities. And again, you see these IPA agreements seem to diminish trade in those low IP kinds of commodities. I don't have a great answer for why that is. Other than these things do focus their energies on more technology-oriented kinds of commodities. But what about these other, you don't see a lot here, but if you look at the bio sector, this biopharmaceuticals, the high-income countries do seem to have a substantially positive effect on their exports. So you're right, we need to take the U.S. and Europe out of here and see if that's what it is. But also medical devices. So this suggestion, not a lot of significant coefficients to it, to say the least, but the suggestion here is that at least at this level, when these countries join such an agreement, there is an effect on these particular products that are specifically protected by these IP chapters. I don't know if you want to go through this. This is just a demonstration of what these coefficients are. Not many of them are completely above or below zero, but you can see that exports are diminished by these agreements, but in the case of biopharmaceuticals, the high-income countries have this positive effect pretty clearly. And that turns out to be consistent throughout. I don't know if I want to, this is the imports story. And here, the positive coefficient there for biopharmaceuticals, again, only for the high-income countries, so they're trading back and forth when they join these agreements. But there's not a lot going on otherwise. Bilateral results are actually a little bit more. So now conclusions came before. Sorry about that. I don't know. Okay, so we also see these regressions incorporate bilateral trade. That's going to have all the parafixed effects and the usual things you expect in the gravity model. Okay. We find that the exporter outcomes are consistent mostly with these prior findings. There are going to be significant increases in exports of, here's bio, you can see these products, right? So in terms of the upper middle income countries and high income countries, there's this expansion of exports. Biopharmaceuticals and this information technology group. But maybe there's some diminution of exports out of these upper middle income countries and chemicals. I don't really pretend to have a good story for why that would be yet. But you can see that there are these correlations going on in the data. They're a little bit intriguing. TRIPS is, with a few exceptions, just not there. Doesn't seem to have the effects that these are on these high tech markets. And any more effects? We don't get a lot. So I don't really know if it's worth going through these or not, but there is some sort of suggestion. What these IP related trade agreements do in these high tech goods is expand exports by the high income countries, diminish imports by the middle income and low income countries. There's sort of comparative advantage effect. But it does suggest in that context that what they're doing is actually providing more export opportunities, places like the United States and Europe. So we should take them out and see. know a lot in this context. So, as I said, this is, at this point, just a straightforward empirical exercise to see what's there. There's a lot of work to be done to try to get this into some believable format and to put some framework into it. That's where we are at this point. I guess I'll go back to where that concluding slide was and how I got there. I don't know. So some initial evidence of these IP-related preferential trade agreements have some effect on trade composition. So the imports of these high IP goods the exports are the ones that are more sensitive than these middle-income and higher-income countries. And some of these, I know where it is. This is, hold on a second. Yeah. What was there was a conclusion section from an earlier draft. That's why I was so here. I'd go through and take that out. So this proliferation of these agreements really hasn't been systematically studied yet. Needs to be a lot more work done here, but we have a mostly a negative outcome. Controlling for trips, additional effects of these IPA memberships largely just insignificant. But there are these notable exceptions in some of these sectors. So in IPAs, the imports of low IP goods fall, but exports of low IP goods fall at higher income levels. So in the context of the controlled goods, these high IP, these low IP goods, there seem to be some sort of sorting by comparative advantage. Exports of biopharmaceuticals and medical devices are stimulated among high-income countries by membership in these agreements. So if, in fact, this is the objective, or one of the objectives that the high-income countries have by negotiating these agreements, it seems to work. And then exports of biopharmaceuticals and ICT technology are stimulated among the upper-middle-income countries by membership in these agreements. And these two sectors are the ones that have the strongest provisions in these trade agreements. So, you know, like I said, we're some distance from getting any kind of real results here, but I think there's some intriguing stuff going on that seems to be sorting out these trade volumes effects, trade composition effects, in ways that you might expect from these agreements. So, maybe it's the case that these IP-related preferential trade agreements are trade-related. In this limited context. Some ways to take this, if we ever get to additional research, well, we'd like to distinguish between final goods and intermediate goods here, because that's an interesting question about what IP protection does to goods within supply chains. Extend this bilateral analysis to a consideration of whether these agreements have differential effects on trade creation, trade diversion. So I'm hoping to have some results to present to you today. Looking at bilateral trade within these agreements and outside these agreements, but this is an interesting question because you know these agreements are discriminatory in terms of tariff cuts. They're not discriminatory in terms of their IP relations, and nobody's actually studied whether there are impacts on trade within the region or outside the region as a result of that. And then try to incorporate measures of the channels through which these IPAs may actually be operating in trade. What's it that's driving this? Is it just the tariff cuts? Or is there some relationship between these IP standards? All right. I think I'll stop there because I'm going to reach up my gift for speaking for the last 5 hours.